Some of our Protestant brothers and sisters seem to have a problem with our devotion to the Blessed Mother. They don't quite understand it. And they'll use this gospel passage to try to say that Jesus does not want us honoring his mother. And of course, that's the furthest thing from the truth, is what's happening here. What Jesus is pointing out here is that Mary was not blessed simply because she happened to give birth to Jesus, but that she heard the word of God and kept it. Remember that Mary didn't just happen to give birth to somebody who became great. From the very beginning, she was asked by God if she would cooperate, and she said yes. So by the Lord's words, happier still, those who hear the word of God and keep it. Mary certainly did that, and she kept it perfectly. And so she is a perfect model for us in following the Lord. And proper devotion to Mary is proper devotion to Jesus. Some of you I've noticed, as well as other people, in St. Anne's, whenever my mother comes by, I know a lot of you give her a lot of deference. People make a little fuss over her. Do you think whenever I see that, I'm saying, why are you giving honor to my mother and not to me? Well, of course not. By giving honor to my mother, you are giving honor to me. You're showing your love for me by showing honor for my mother. Well, the same thing with the Lord Jesus. By showing honor to his mother, we are showing honor to him. And so as we go through our pilgrimage, let us ask our Blessed Mother to be our patron for everything we see and everything we do, to be the one that guides us, that strengthens us, and by her example helps us to truly be the disciples of Jesus that we are meant to be, that we indeed will have heard his voice and his word and followed it. May Jesus Christ be praised, now and forever.
Say it was the first, the precursor of the Vatican, the place where Peter would have meetings and things. Anybody, any church things that happened took place at that house. Now there's a church on the site of it. Also, there is the chair that St. Peter is supposedly used when he was there, or presiding at liturgy or wherever, is now enshrined. You're going to see tomorrow in the gold chair, the throne of St. Peter in the apse of St. Peter's Basilica. So we're going back to the very first century here for this site. This is St. Peter's first home base, if you will.
Celebrate Mass in this beautiful basilica right over the tomb of St. Peter, but at the very tomb of one of the greatest popes that we've ever known, St. John Paul II. And as we hear the words in the Gospel this morning talking about the Lord giving to the simplest of people and the simplest of children,
If you look at the life of John Paul II, he was indeed that, a very simple and humble man who did tremendous things, almost single-handedly brought down communism, and changed so much in the world simply because he believed that Christ could do great things through him, and he gave into the Lord his complete life. And he said, Lord, my life is at your service. And his motto was of the words to the Blessed Mother, Totus Tuus, all yours. And so, as he gave himself completely to the Lord and to the Blessed Mother as his special patron, may we do that in our lives as we're here on our pilgrimage. May we say to the Lord, Lord, I give you everything. I am all yours. I am totus tuus. Do with me whatever you will, and that is fine by me. And if we do that, the Lord can work miracles through us. He can move mountains. Indeed, he can change the world. May Jesus Christ be praised.
Now and forever.
On this side, Charlemagne was crowned the first true Roman Emperor on Christmas Day in the year 800. This very slab we are standing on.
It's like a little red.
about a view from your office.
Wow. The view of your office is the hallway. Your office has the hallway. It's a nice hallway. I hit my head in every time I go down there.
Succede con la passatella, incominciata 30 in osteria e finita a Via dell'Arenella. È notte, tutta Roma sta dormendo, la gente non lo sa che giù per strada un luccichio della...
There's St. Peter's at night. Face of Christ looking at you. Next to him you have four apostles. You have on the left Paul and Luke, and on the right Peter and Andrew. When the lights go on, look at Andrew, because everybody else is looking at Jesus, and Andrew is looking directly at you, pointing to Jesus, and he's basically saying, why are you looking at me? Look at him. Your eyes should be on Christ. Beautiful image of that.
Oh.
Palatine Hill. Houses that would have built on the Palatine Hill are called palatial. We take the word palace from that. You know, that's the most splendid of all houses. Right below it here is the Circus Maximus. And there's only a small portion of the original circus left down at the bottom, a little bit of the base of the grandstand. But they say this thing, when it was full, could hold 100,000 people.
Whoa.
It was used for chariot races. And many Christians would have been martyred.
Tornare in mente passando tu, tra il sorriso dei colli che fincio di Villa Borghese, dalle antiche fontane di chiese, di borghi e di fior, carrozzella romana che porti che senza pretese, sei la reggia più bella dei sogni fugaci d'amore. Trotta, trotta, morello, sui ponti del Tevere ancora. Oh, oh, oh. Carrozzella romana, tu rendi felice ogni cuore. Ti ricordi cari di gioventù, fai ritornare in mente passando tu, tra il sorriso dei corni del Pincio e di Villa Borghese, delle antiche fontane di chiese, di borghi e di fior, carrozzella romana che porti che senza pretese. Sei la reggia più bella dei sogni fugaci d'amore. Oh, oh. Trotta, trotta, morello, sui ponti del Tevere ancora. Carrozzella romana, tu rendi felice ogni
solo tu, se la voce un po' velata accompagnami in sordina la mia bella fornarina al balcone non c'è più Tevere d'orre mentre il fiume cammina io lo seguo perché mi trascina con sé travolge il mio cuore vedo un'ombra lontana e una stella lassù oh chitarra romana accompagnami tu. Se la voce un po' velata accompagnami in sordina mia bella fornarina al balcone non c'è più oh chitarra romana
Yeah.
over left. One, two, three, go. One, two, three, go. One, two, three, go. Okay. One, two, three, go. One, two, three, go. Two, three, go.
Stringevo le mani e la faccia di blu. Poi d'improvviso venivo dal vento rapito e incominciavo a volare nel cielo infinito. Volare, oh, cantare. Nel blu, dipinto di blu, felice di stare lassù. E volavo, volavo felice, più in alto del sole ed ancora più su. Mentre il mondo pian piano spariva lontano laggiù. Una musica dolce suonava soltanto per me. Volare, oh, cantare, oh, 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 nel blu dipinto di blu.
Jesus. Quanto sei bella Roma, quanto sei bella Roma, prima sera. Erette verede serve, erette verede serve da cintura. San Pietro del Campidoglio da lettiera. Quanto sei bella Roma, quanto sei bella Roma a prima sera. Gira se la vuoi gira, canta se la vuoi canta. Trastevere da quando, Trastevere da quando t'ho lasciato. C'avevo in petto cuore, c'avevo in petto cuore, l'ho perduto. Dimmelo bello sì, l'hai ritrovato. Trastevere da quando, Trastevere da quando t'ho lasciato. Gira se la vuoi gira, canta se la vuoi canta. De qua della dara fiume, de qua della dara fiume c'è una stella. E tu non puoi guardarla, e tu non puoi guardarla, tanto brilla. E questa è Roma mia bella, de qua della dara fiume, de qua della dara fiume c'è una stella. Gira se la vuoi gira, canta se la vuoi canta. Bella casetta mia, bella casetta mia trasteverina. E gira intorno il fiume, e gira intorno il fiume, te incorona. E tutta l'aria perata te si inchina. Bella casetta mia, bella casetta mia, trasterina. Gira se la vuoi, gira, canta se la vuoi, canta. Roma che la più bella, Roma che la più bella, sei del mondo. Io penso sto stornello, io penso sto stornello e te lo mando. Tu me parli d'amore, io da rispondo. Roma che la più bella, Roma che la più bella, sei del mondo. Gira se la vuoi, gira, canta se la vuoi, canta.
Wait, wait. Make sure you have the Coke in the shot.
Oh, gotta get the Coke in the shot. This is where we had lunch on Saturday afternoon. Nice little outdoor garden.
Yeah, I know, right? We will leave in less than a week.
Già così lontana, già lontana. Guarda questa terra che gira insieme a noi, anche quando è buio. Guarda questa terra. Per noi a darci un po' di sole, sole, sole. My love, che sei l'amore mio, sento la tua voce. Ascolto il mare, sembra davvero il tuo respiro, l'amore che mi dai, questo amore che sta lì nascosto in mezzo alle sue onde, a tutte le sue onde. Come una barca che guarda questa terra che gira insieme a noi anche quando è buio. Guarda questa terra che per noi a darci un po' di sole, sole.
Sole.
erano già tra I biancospini il vento mormora e va sembra un incanto il bosco sotto la luna favole appassionate narra per te Il suo nome conosco, vuoi conoscerlo tu? Vieni, è la strada del cuore, dove nasce l'amore.
Stabbing you at the base of your skin,
oh,
of your
man,
skull.
Don't do that.
No, I can't do that with two fingers. But I could do the other. And two fingers would be enough.
I wouldn't go for takedown.
Two fingers through the throat down to the heart. Oh. Let's say a sword. Through the throat down to the heart.
Oh man, I'm
dead. In a couple seconds, you are gone.
I'm dead, yeah.
Yeah,
but you live. Hey.
Hey.
You were spirit.
Ah, cuore mio da fior a fior, con dolcezza e con amor, vai tu per me. Qua che la mia felicità vive solo di realtà, vicino a te. Voglio vivere così, col sole in fronte, e felice tanto. Beatamente voglio vivere e godere l'aria del monte perché questo incanto non costa niente ah, oggi amo ardentemente quell'uccello impertinente menestrello dell'amore ah, la fiorita delle piante viene in festa a questo cuore sole d'or m'accarezzi dai calore sei buono tu tu che respiri il mio respir ogni pena sai lenir campagna tu voglio vivere così col sole in fronte fronte e felice canto beatamente. Voglio vivere e goder l'aria del monte, perché questo incanto non costa niente. Oggi amo ardentemente quel ruscello impertinente, menestrello del lavoro. La fiorita delle piante che l'infesta questo cuore, sai perché? Voglio vivere così, con la sola in fronte, e felice canto, canto per te.
L'amore ne teneva incatenata, ho detto basta e me so liberata. Me pare che turchino cielo, me pare che lucendo sole, a cuore canta pa' felicità. Che la la, che la la, mo vo dicendo che me vola sa. Se crede che mi faccio sangue amare, si crede che impazzisco che può mi spara, che la la, che la la, non sape a chi piacere che mi fa. Me ne piglio annata che bella e zitella resterà, che la la, che la la, che la la. A ieri m'ha mannato un biglietto, fa figlia d'un portiere di rippetto. Mi scrive che non è felice e che vorria con me fa pace, e io me sto gustando la libertà. La la, che la la, mo vo dicendo che me vola sta. Si crede che mi faccio sangue amare, si crede che impazzisco e poi mi sparo, che la la, che la la, non sappa di piacere che mi fa. Me ne piglio annata che bella
e zitella resterà,
che la la, che la la, che la la.
Che la la, che la la, mo va dicendo che me vola sta. Se crede che me faccio sangue amare, se crede che pazzisco e poi mi spare.
Che la la, che la la, non sa di chi piacere che me fa. Me ne piglio all'altra più bella e zitella resterà, che la la, 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 che la la.
whose gift St. Francis was conformed to Christ in poverty and humility. Grant that by walking in Francis' footsteps, we may follow your Son and through joyful charity come to be united with you. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Galatians. Brothers, may I never boast of anything but the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Through it, the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. It means nothing whether one is circumcised or not. All that matters is that one is created anew. Peace and mercy and all who follow this rule of life and on the Israel of God. Henceforth, let no man trouble me, for I bear the brand marks of Jesus in my body. Brothers, may the favor of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May I go.
Ti ringraziamo, Dio nostro Padre, perché sei amore. Tu ci hai fatto dono della vita e ci hai creati per essere figli tuoi. Ti ringraziamo perché ci fai partecipi della tua opera creatrice, dandoci un mondo da plasmare con le nostre mani. Ti ringraziamo, Signore Gesù, perché per amore nostro sei venuto in questo mondo per riscattarci da ogni male e riportarci al Padre. Ti ringraziamo perché sei rimasto in mezzo a noi per sempre, per far di tutti gli uomini una sola famiglia, un corpo solo in te.
Thank you.
Ti ringraziamo, Spirito d'amore, perché rinnovi la faccia della terra. Tu dai luce e conforto ad ogni cuore. Ti ringraziamo perché con i tuoi santi doni ci dai la forza di avanzare nel nostro cammino per giungere uniti alla gioia della tua casa.
A squarciarelli, fettuccine, vino dei castelli, come i tempi belli che Pinelli immortalò. Arrivederci Roma.
Travel halfway across the world and met my family, my mom, my friends. And we went to a foreign country. Are we going off to war?
We made a lot of memories. Some of us made new friends. Others strengthened their friendships. We had a lot of fun despite all the confusion and the walking and the tiredness at the end of every day. We made it, whether it killed us or it didn't. Let's go home, take the memories of this trip with us forever. And I want to say one last thing. Can I get a Steve?
This was the stadium of the Emperor Domitian. The ruins of some of it are underneath on the other side. I can show you some of them when we go out that end. So this station was just taken over. Probably many Christians were martyred here. And this is the famous church of Sant'Agnese Nagone. And from the Nagone, which was the name of the valley where it was in, they got Navona. My favorite story about this place was the first time I was coming to Italy when I met you guys. My father had a friend who once was passed away, but when he heard I was coming to Rome, he calls me and says, you have to look for this out of the place, out of the beaten path, little place that most people don't know, but it's so beautiful. It's called Piazza Navona. I came and I saw this and said, this is off the beaten path. This guy also said, Fountain of Trevi was, I don't know what they're making a big deal about, you can walk past it and miss it. Whatever he saw was not the Fountain of Trevi, as
you
call it.
Alright, you know what we gotta hear? One, two, three.
Shame! Some of our Protestant brothers and sisters seem to have a problem with our devotion to the Blessed Mother. They don't quite understand it. And they'll use this gospel passage to try to say that Jesus does not want us honoring his mother. And of course, that's the furthest thing from the truth, is what's happening here. What Jesus is pointing out here is that Mary was not blessed simply because she happened to give birth to Jesus, but that she heard the word of God and kept it. Remember that Mary didn't just happen to give birth to somebody who became great. From the very beginning, she was asked by God if she would cooperate, and she said yes. So by the Lord's words, happier still those who hear the word of God and keep it. Mary certainly did that, and she kept it perfectly. And so she is a perfect model for us in following the Lord. And proper devotion to Mary is proper devotion to Jesus. Some of you have noticed, as well as other people in St. Anne's, whenever my mother comes by, I know a lot of people give her a lot of deference. People make a think whenever I see that, I'm saying, why are you giving honor to my mother and not to me? Well, of course not. By giving honor to my mother, you are giving honor to me. You're showing your love for me by showing honor for my mother. Well, the same thing with the Lord Jesus. By showing honor to his mother, we are showing honor to him. And so as we go through our pilgrimage, let us ask our Blessed Mother to be our patron for everything we see and everything we do, to be the one that guides us, that strengthens us, and by her example helps us to truly be the disciples of Jesus that we are meant to be, that we indeed will have heard his voice and his word and followed him. May Jesus Christ be praised, now and forever. Please stand.
Greater privilege that we have, not only to be able to celebrate Mass in this beautiful basilica right over the tomb of St. Peter, but at the very tomb of one of the greatest popes that we've ever known, St. John Paul II. And as we hear the words in the Gospel this morning talking about the Lord giving to the simplest of people and the simplest of children, if you look at the life of John Paul II, he was indeed that, a very simple and humble man, who did tremendous things, almost single-handedly brought down communism, and changed so much in the world simply because he believed that Christ could do great things through him. And he gave into the Lord his complete life. And he said, Lord, my life is at your service. And his motto was of the words to the Blessed Mother, Totus Tuus, all yours. And so, as he gave himself completely to the Lord and to the Blessed Mother as a special patron, may we do that in our lives as we're here on our pilgrimage. May we say to the Lord, Lord, I give you everything. I am all yours. I am totus tuus. Do with me whatever you will, and that is fine by me. And if we do that, the Lord can work miracles through us. He can move mountains. Indeed, he can change the world. May Jesus Christ be praised.
Now and forever.
If any of you feel that at any time you've lost your way, or you look back on your previous life and the sins you may have committed at some time and feel unworthy of the Lord, well, have I got a saint for you? St. Paul is certainly somebody who would have every reason to regret the way he lived. And yet, one thing to remember about St. Paul is he wasn't an evil sinner going out doing horrible things and living a life of debauchery and everything like that. He was a devout Pharisee. He was devoted to the Lord, and he tells us that he went to great lengths to keep all the laws of Israel, and he was holy and pious before the Lord in all the outward ways of doing things. But he missed the point of it all, for when Jesus came along, he did not embrace the new way in the Gospel, but he rejected it. He saw him as a false Messiah and one violating all the ways of the Jewish faith, and he felt it his duty to persecute this new way and to try to eradicate it because he felt it was loathsome to God. And on, as you may know, on his way to Damascus, he, the Pharisee, he had received letters from the high priest authorizing him to go to Damascus and arrest any Jews that were found worshiping Jesus and following his way and bring them back to Jerusalem for punishment. And along the way on the road to Damascus, a bright light shone and struck him down. And he heard a voice saying, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? And he said, Who are you, sir? And he said, I am Jesus, the one who are persecuting. One whom you are persecuting. And he says, what shall I do? He says, go into the city and you will be told what to do. And he was blinded. He was kept blind for 3 days by the Lord. While he was there, he went to the house of a man named Ananias on Straight Street, as the name of the street was. And for 3 days he ate and drank nothing. During that time, the Lord Jesus revealed himself to him. And 3 days later, Ananias, as the apostle, or the disciple, sent to him. He was staying at the house of a man called Simon. And the Lord said to him, Ananias, go to Straight Street and find Saul of Tarsus, and there you shall baptize. And he objected. He said, Lord, we've heard about him. This is the guy who's come to arrest us and lead us all out for punishment. He says, you must go. He's the one I've chosen to bring my name to the Gentiles. And so he went to him. He said, Saul, my brother, God has sent me to you. And he healed him. Something like fish scales fell out of his eyes. He was able to see. He took some food. He was baptized. And the next day he went into the synagogue. And yet instead of going in to arrest all of the believers in Jesus that were there, he started preaching that Jesus was the Messiah. And the people were amazed that the one who was formerly persecuting us He had to be struck down. Tradition has put him on a horse, and we've often talked about being struck down from your horse the way St. Paul was. And it is said that as a sign of his new life, he changed his name and took the name of Paul. And from that time, we knew him as Paul, and he was the greatest evangelist and preacher the world has ever known. He took the faith to the ends of the earth better than anyone else. And so much of the world believed in Christ because of the message of Paul. And once converted, all of that zeal he was using to fight the faith, he now used to preach it. And he was passionate and zealous for the faith of Jesus, sometimes even to the point of the extreme, it seems. But he says at some points he suffered tremendously for the Lord, being stoned and to death, almost nearly to death, being scourged, being shipwrecked several times. And yet he wrote of it, he says, what does it matter? All that matters to me is that Christ be preached to as many people as possible, whether I live or I die, for to me life is Christ. And that is a wonderful motto for us to remember, to live for Christ, to give our lives totally to him, as St. Paul did. We don't know what it will mean for us to give our lives completely to the Lord, but whether we rejoice or whether we must suffer, and Paul did suffer quite a bit for the gospel, when he did, he rejoiced in his weaknesses. He rejoiced in his sufferings because he said, through them I am being brought closer to Christ. And the people, at least some of those, he says, I preach to everyone, I try to be all things to everyone, so at least some of them can be saved. And he rejoiced that if at least some people were saved in Christ by his sacrifice, that it was all worth it. And of course, many people were brought to the faith by Paul. And he created numerous churches throughout the ancient world, places that looked to Paul to bring them the faith. Many of the early Christian churches were started by St. Paul. Oddly enough, the only one that was not was Rome. But he came to Rome, he wrote his letter to them, and when he came here, he was embraced by the people of Rome. And ultimately, he was a martyr here. And just a few miles down the road, in a place called Re Fontane, he was a martyr. Probably not during Nero's persecution, as Peter was. Probably a few years later, he came back to Rome and then was martyred. And he was buried in a vineyard. A pious Christian woman had a vineyard, and she buried his body in the middle of the vineyard. And that vineyard is where we are now, just a few yards away under the high altar that you see in the church of St. Paul's tomb. And so, as we continue our pilgrimage, let us ask St. Paul to help us to be steadfast as he was, to not worry about what it costs us to follow the Lord, but only to say, Lord, I give my life totally to you. I don't care what I have to suffer. I don't care what pains it brings me. As long as your name is preached, let me do that, Lord, no matter what it costs. For to me, life is Christ. May Jesus Christ be praised. Now and forever.
When we talk about the Pope and the authorities of the Church, many people in the world get this idea that somehow the Pope is here to impose things on us, that people who don't follow the Church are free, that they're going about doing whatever they want, and we as Catholics are slaving like Atlas carrying the weight of the world on our shoulders by trying to follow what the Church teaches. It's quite the opposite. I don't think it's faithful Catholics who are enslaved. The people who are enslaved are those who are living in sin. They think they're free, but what is it giving them? Oh, it gives them maybe the freedom of not feeling guilty, that they don't feel they have to listen to anyone else, so there's no sense of guilt on their conscience. But is it really leading them to happiness? How many people in the world have you met today that you would honestly say, I look at him or her and say, that person is really happy, is really content? Most likely, it's somebody who is faithful to Christ. Those in the Church, those who are faithful to the Lord, do we walk around looking gloomy and miserable? I look at you guys, and I mean, you're all pretty faithful. We all have our sins, I know that. And there are all times when we fall short in following the Lord. But all of us, I think, are trying in our hearts to be faithful to Christ. When we fall short, we confess our sins, of course. But is there any one of us here who feels like, here I am slaving following Jesus and feeling resentful of all the people in the world that seem to go out and commit all this sin and get away with it? I think it's quite the opposite. I think they should be envious of us because they see the joy that we have. Because the Lord's law is not enslaving, it's liberating. It's freeing us from the shackles of sin. Sin enslaves. Christ frees. Look at anyone who has an addiction. an addiction to alcohol, an addiction to drugs, to cigarettes, to sex, to gambling, whatever it could be, they are enslaved. They are the ones who know they are working very hard in 10-step and 12-step programs and things to break the chains of their slavery. When we are remained faithful to the Lord is showing us how to avoid all those things that would enslave us. And he promised by giving the authority to Peter, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the jaws of death shall not prevail against it, and I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. What you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven, and what you let loose on earth shall be let loose in heaven. In doing that, he gave us the absolute gift of the authority of the church that the Lord was telling Peter and tells us. When the Pope speaks definitively, we know he is speaking the word of the Lord, and we can follow it with absolute confidence because we know this is Christ teaching us through him. No other religion can say that. Our Protestant brothers and sisters who broke away and didn't want the power of the Lord, they didn't want the power of the Pope and having to listen to him, and they went off on their own, what's happened to them? After they broke away, were they all united with each other? Oh no, they fractured into thousands of denominations, fighting against each other, disagreeing, and each pointing to the other one as being right and wrong, and all this stuff. And there's no unity among the Protestants. We as Catholics have a much greater unity of faith, and we have a peace that the others don't have, because they lost that promise that the Lord gives us. And so having the authority of the Holy Father is not something that enslaves, but something that liberates us. Because we know we can stand clearly on the teaching of Christ through the Holy Father. And when we look through the history of the Church in 2,000 years, even though there have been some popes who morally were an embarrassment and some of the things they did, they were not the greatest example, no pope has ever had to revoke a firm teaching of any other pope. And that is promised to us that even in the worst of people, the Lord will promise to keep the faith, and the Lord can light straight through crooked lines, that it is not the personal morality of the Pope that is the source of our holiness and of our teaching, but the promise that the Holy Spirit will guide the Church. And so today, as we celebrate Mass in this beautiful cathedral of Rome, the most important church of all the world, in Latin it is referred to as Omnium Ecclesiae Orbis et Orbis Mater et Capo, the mother and head of all the churches of Rome and of the world. If we were to say which is the single most important church in the world, it is this church, St. John's in the Lateran, because this is the Pope's church as the Bishop of Rome and the head of all the world. And so this is the greatest or the most important church that exists in Christendom. And we remember the Holy Father and pray for him, and we can thank the Lord today for this great gift of the papacy, the great gift of the magisterium of the Church, because we can know with certainty when the Pope and the Church teach something with authority, it is definitely the voice of the Lord, the voice which frees us, which allows us to be freed from the errors that enslave so many other denominations of Christianity that reject that power. With the reminder of the Pope's authority, we live in peace, the peace of the freedom of knowing that we are taught by Christ. Now, it is not always easy to follow the teaching of the Lord, and many people have rejected it over the years because they found it too hard to follow. But by not following it has not given them peace. They maybe have somebody they can blame for their unhappiness, and they can point the fingers at the Church and the Pope and be angry at them. But notice it doesn't give them any peace. The only people who find peace are the people who find the strength to follow the Lord and make the sacrifices, however great they may be, to make sure our lives are always in line with the gospel. And when we meet people who have done so, they have such a peace that inspires us. They are joyful, like St. Philip Neri that we saw earlier today, and they inspire us to want to follow God to the best of our ability, knowing that their peace is what we desire. And when we live completely faithful to the teachings of the Church, we know the peace of Christ, the peace that sets us free. May Jesus Christ be praised.
Now and forever.
Please stand.
I'm in awe of the thought that we're able to celebrate Mass here in the catacombs the same way the ancient Christians did. And while we're here on pilgrimage in perfect safety, remember the ancient Christians who came down here not just to bury their dead, but they knew they were safe during times of persecution. Not because, as some people used to think, that the Romans didn't know about the catacombs and that they were a secret place where they could hide. The Romans knew very well about the catacombs, but they were highly superstitious. Because dead people were buried here, they were afraid that if they violated the tombs of the dead, their spirits would haunt them. And rarely did they overcome them. One was, as Father was telling us beforehand in the tour, about when they came down and arrested Sixtus in the second. We'll speak a little bit more about that later on, because it has to do with St. Lawrence as well. But they came down here knowing they were at least safe while they were here. They couldn't stay here forever, obviously. They couldn't live in the catacombs, and they had to leave. But they knew every time they celebrated Mass here and left, there could be somebody up there who would arrest them, and the next day they might be thrown to the lions during the days of persecution. And what great witness they showed by being willing to do what they did in order to keep the faith alive. And we might wonder, sometimes on the outside people would say, why does God let that happen to people? Here in the earliest days, these were people who were trying so much to follow God in a day when it wasn't popular. Why would God let them suffer so much? Well, there's two things we can say about that. First, remembering one of the images Father mentioned to us that was very common here, and that is the dove with the olive branch, the symbol of triumph, of victory. In ancient days, in the Greek games and everything, in the Roman games, the winner would receive a laurel wreath. And of course, that dove branch, which reminds us of Noah and the flood, was also a reminder to the people then that they have won the victory. Any of you who play sports know how much more is a victory meaningful when you've defeated a very difficult team. If you go through something and there's a team who's nowhere up to your ability, and you're playing baseball, for example, and you defeat them with 34-0, you know, you just say, you know, this was a piece of cake. But when you have to take on a hard team and you beat them, well, you feel much better afterwards. And if you have this fantastic team and you destroy them, you might mop the field with them, people look to you and say, wow, look at what they did. They were a tremendous team. Same with the Christians. It would be very easy for people to follow the Lord and be Christians if God made every one of them a healthy millionaire. People would be becoming Christians for all the wrong reasons. But become a Christian knowing that the price to pay for it might be torture and death, but remembering that if I do that, the promised life of heaven, as all the other symbols said, that even if we're crucified, even if we're burned at the stake, even if we're fed to lions, Christ is giving us heaven. Well, the victory that is there, that we have survived the time of great trial. And in our own world today, the more, as we see from the ancient Christians, the more Christianity caught on and the stronger it became in society, the more threat it was to other people, and the persecutions only intensified. Do we not see that in our own day? That we as Catholics, who are one of the few churches that hold to the traditions, hold to the teachings of Christ, the morality, and everything else, while all the others are caving in and accepting what's popular, and we say, no, God's way is the right way. And do we not see so many people in society that are persecuting us all the more? Have we not seen administrations and government that have tried to force us to violate our beliefs, just like the ancient Romans tried to force the Christians to violate their beliefs and offer incense to idols? And they used to say, offer incense to the gods of Rome and we'll set you free. But they said, no, we are Christians. We don't offer incense to idols. Well, today you can see, for example, the last administration that was saying, change your teachings on abortion and contraception, allow them, and we'll give you all the money you want to run your hospitals. And we said, no, cut off all the money if you want. We don't provide abortions. We don't believe in contraception. We will not give in to that. And we've been persecuted for it. So in many ways, we're just like the martyrs of old. And yet in that witness, so many people are brought to the faith. One of the Roman emperors was known to say, for every Christian I put to death in an arena, two pagans go out converted. And he knew it was like spreading water on a grease fire, because in a day when nobody really found anything worth believing in, certainly worth dying for, here were Christians who were willing to die for that faith, and they sang of it. And as they were put to death, they even sang and encouraged one another. And they encouraged others to live that same faith. And if we look to the very first persecution by the Emperor Nero, before all that happened with the great fire and he blamed the Christians for it, beforehand in Rome, Christianity was a very small sect. How many people knew about the Christians? Probably only a few. After the great fire and the first persecution, everybody in Rome would have known about the Christians. So the death of the martyrs spread the faith because now people were open. They understood it. And many people by the end, one of the reasons the great persecution by Nero, or the first persecution, I should say, ended was because people got tired of it. And as Tacitus said, they said, people were saying, even if the Christians were responsible for the fire, the punishment was out of all proportion to the crime. And so they became sympathetic to the Christians. Same thing happened in the Great Persecution at the turn of the 4th century, where the Emperor Diocletian thought, if I don't wipe out Christianity now, we're never going to get rid of it. And by the end, it ended because people were getting tired of 8 years of bloodbath, and they became sympathetic to the Christians. And so the martyrs who shed their blood brought so much of the faith to so many others. And as one of the great ancient fathers had said, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the faith. In the sacrifice that the ancient Christians were willing to lay down, so many other people embraced Christ. And that's our challenge today. You and I in the United States may not ever ask to be physically lay down our lives and spill our blood for the Lord, although there are places in the world where they are still doing that. But in our country, it's more of a moral or spiritual martyrdom, where they're telling us to lay down our morals, lay down our beliefs, lay down everything in the name of toleration, in the name of acceptance, in the name of everything they claim that is the modern beliefs that they tell us we're hate-filled because we don't hold them. And we say, no, say what you want, we follow Christ. We don't do those things, and we will not accept it, even if all the rest of the world has. And that is our challenge to martyrdom, to be able to remain faithful to Christ, even if it costs us much, even if at some point somebody loses a job or feels they have to move elsewhere to a safer place, whatever it may be. When we get those moments, may we remember what we do here today, and remembering the faith of the martyrs that we have encountered today and at other times in our pilgrimage. And may we always remain faithful to Christ as the martyrs did, knowing that even if we suffer now, the promise of eternal life is waiting for us in heaven. May Jesus Christ be praised.
Now and forever.
Some of you have been asking me about what happens when a priest goes to sin and he goes to confession. He hears his own confession. And of course, the answer is no. Priests have to go to another priest for confession. And of course, priests are all sinners, like anyone else. Sometimes those sins are so serious that they have sacrificed all credibility and are a danger to other people, and they have to be removed from ministry. And it's very sad and harmful to the faithful and to everyone else when that does happen. But outside of those extreme situations, all of us are sinners. And sometimes you hear people talking about the sins of priests. They'll point out, Father said this or Father did that. Well, we're no exception. If we're looking for sinless priests to serve before you, there'll be nobody, because there are no sinless people in the world anymore. We had Jesus and Mary, and that's it. And the Lord knows that. He knows that he requires, or he counts on sinners to be able to minister to him. Even look at St. Peter. We're here in this beautiful church of St. Peter in chains on Canterbury Pinkley. And underneath the main altar are the chains that Peter held. Sometimes people will even point out, some of them may be self-righteously, about the fact that Peter denied knowing Jesus three times the night before he died. And Jesus knew he was going to do that. He said it beforehand at the Last Supper and told him, you will deny me three times. But afterwards, what did Jesus do at the Sea of Galilee? Three times he asked him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And three times Peter had to reaffirm his faith. He didn't even realize what Jesus was doing. He asked him, Lord, you know everything. You know I love you. Why are you asking me this? Three times Peter denied him out of fear. Three times he reaffirmed him in love. And Jesus each time reaffirmed him, feed my flock, shepherd my lambs, feed my lambs, over and over again. In other words, Jesus says, your sins, Peter, do not stand in the way of you serving me. You can still be the shepherd of the flock that I have asked you to be, to represent me, even though you sinned grievously by even denying me three times. And our priests today are the same thing. And lots of people today will ask the question, you know, why do we not have the number of priests we have? What's keeping young people from becoming priests? Well, in the young people I have talked with over the years, it's not the things that some people point out. It's not celibacy. It's not all the other stuff. In fact, a large time, I find that many young people I talk to about who might be thinking about the priesthood have said, oh, no, not me. I could never do that. It's because they don't feel worthy. They see priests in their parish or in their schools, wherever they are, and they say, I love Father. I respect everything Father many of our parishes do not have a priest. That one priest has the coverage of three parishes because we don't have the priests that we need. There's a variety of reasons that are beyond our ability to discuss today. But one thing to remember is that a lot of the times we worry and we're worthy. Well, I thought the same thing when I was a boy. There was a priest in my parish when I was growing up, Father Kenny. He taught me to be an altar boy. He taught our classroom, and I loved Father Kenny. I had him on a pedestal. When I first thought God was calling me to be a priest, I remember thinking of that and saying, how can I do what Father Kenny does? He's so great. He's so wonderful. Fortunately, a wise priest, when I was in college, said to me, you don't need credentials in order to be a priest. All you need is one thing, that God is calling you to ministry. He says, if God is calling you, he will give you all the gifts you need to do his will. So don't be afraid. I'm sure he says to me, he says, I never met Father Kenny, but I'm sure he had his own sins. And there were weaknesses to him. I remember the time he got angry at people in church and took the Lord's name in vain. My little brother was serving for him. Julian is his father, and I'll never forget that. He actually on the altar sat there and took the Lord's name in vain. That's a sin. But priests are not sinless people. We are not in church. Now that gathering of people that passes on Sunday is not a gathering of saints. We are not a museum of holy people. We are a field hospital. We are a gathering of sinners trying to become saints. And the priest is chosen by the Lord, sometimes not because he has great credentials, but often because he has the least credentials, to show the power of God. That if I could tell you what I was like as a boy, I think a lot of people would have said when I was a kid, I'm a priest, are you crazy? But God can do great things if we give him permission. Some of you boys here, I've mentioned to a few of you, I think they have a vocation to the priesthood. I don't say that to embarrass you or to scare anyone in the face or anything like that, so I'm not looking at anyone. But if you think at any time God is calling you to the priesthood, do not be afraid. Don't think you can't do it. All you need, all God needs, is for you to say yes to him. And no matter what your weaknesses are, even in spite of your weaknesses, God can do great things and will lead a lot of people closer to you because you are willing to serve him. All God needs is you to say yes, and he will give you all the gifts you need. God, the will of God will never call us to where his grace cannot sustain us. So do not be afraid to accept that call. Obviously, not everybody here is going to be called to be a priest. But all of us are called in one way or another to shepherd the people. If not to be the shepherd in the parish, to assist the shepherd. To be the shepherd, if you will, of your own family, if you get married and raise children. So, in all ways, we're called to be Christ followers. If you think you can't be a parent because you have sins, well, look at your own parents, and they sinless. I doubt it, but they probably done a good job with you. I know they have, and they love you very much, even with their faults. You see how God works. God doesn't look for perfect people. He looks for humble people. He looks for people who realize our need for God to work in our lives, and say, Lord, left to myself, I can do nothing. But with you, I can do great things if I allow you to work for me. And that's what St. Peter did. And even in the midst, in spite of his denial of the Lord, look at the great things Peter was able to do. Ultimately, even coming to Rome and shepherding the church here, and his descendants down to Pope Francis today, being the shepherds of a million Catholics worldwide. Do not be afraid. Give your life to Jesus, and he can do great things with you. He will move mountains. He will work miracles. May Jesus Christ be praised. Now and forever.
St. Francis of Assisi is one of the world's most beloved saints and also one of the world's most misunderstood saints. I think most people see Francis as some sort of medieval hippie, you know, some guy who's just skipping through the fields, smelling flowers and petting birds and all that stuff. And there definitely was a love of Francis for God's creatures, no question about that. But it was far more than the hippie generation who seemed to love nature for nature's sake. He loved everything God created because all of it spoke of him to God and revealed God in everything he saw. And so that was his great love of the creatures. And in the Canticle of the Creatures, a portion of which we sang in our opening hymn, notice how he gives praise to God for all of his creatures because of all of them show God's greatness, that everything was created for us. And that's one of the reasons why he is the patron saint of all sorts of conservation efforts and ecological works. But there's another side of Francis that most people don't realize, and that was the real thing for him, and that was the cross of Christ. Francis would meditate upon the cross of Christ frequently, often to the point of tears. And at one point in his life, he prayed and said, "Lord, please help me to know as best as I can in my human body the pain that you endured on the cross to save us. But help me also know in my heart as much as I can the love with which you willingly accepted that cross." And his wish was granted to him 2 years before he died. As he was praying at Mount Alverna, a seraph came to him and gave him the wounds of Christ, the stigmata on his body, the first known person to bear those wounds. Francis wanted to identify with Christ completely. In many ways, some people have actually said that he's even more of a challenge than Jesus himself, because Christ at least was divine. Christ could not commit a sin. And we'd say, well, Jesus did all these things, yeah, but he's God. But Francis followed him practically perfectly, almost flawlessly, and he was not God. He was just a human being. And one of the things I've always noticed about Francis is he was very much human and very much molded in the image and likeness of Christ. He had a great sense of humor about him. You may know that Francis of Assisi gave us the first nativity set. On Christmas Eve in the year 1223 AD, he had somebody bring all the different things that they had to this cave, and they used a doll for the child Jesus. And every time, as he was reading the Christmas story, every time he got to the name Bethlehem in Italian, which is Betlemme, he bleated like a child and made all the children laugh. So he was very much a fun-loving young man, as he had been in his youth, happy-go-lucky. He turns that around to serve the Lord with a joyfulness, somewhat like we found in St. Philip Neri the other day, but also greatly devoted to the Lord. And they say that that Christmas Eve, that the child in the manger, the doll that was there, actually came to life briefly while he was celebrating that Mass. And so much of our tradition, so much of our love for the poor, comes from St. Francis. I told you earlier about the story about him and the leper. He went out not trying to be learned, not looking for people to have degrees and things. He simply wanted to serve poor people. He allowed himself to be ordained a deacon so he could preach the gospel, but he did not even find himself worthy of the holy priesthood. But he followed the Lord, and he got many people around him, and even by the towards the end of his life, the famous meeting of the Mats, where nearly a million people came. Oh, by then he already had that many followers. Among them was St. Anthony, who came up and met Francis there. And Francis was so impressed by the knowledge and learning and humbleness and prayerfulness of Anthony that Anthony was able to convince Francis to allow him to teach theology to the brothers, telling him that if they're going to preach and serve, they do need to know the truth about the faith. And so he softened Francis on that. He died in 1226, and as I was mentioning to you earlier, while in the beginning of his life they thought he was a fool, by the very end they started realizing a great saint lives among us. We could talk for hour after hour after hour about the beautiful gifts of Francis of Assisi. But I would encourage you today, as we're here to pray, asking the Lord just to help you be able to give yourself totally and completely to Christ in whatever way he would have us do. As we heard, he said to the Lord, "Lord, what would you have me do?" Let that be our prayer to him. Lord, what do you want me to do for you? And then when we hear it, give us the strength to carry it out, and we can do great things for the Lord, as did Il Poverello, the little poor man, St. Francis of Assisi. May Jesus Christ be praised.
Now and forever.
Gospel reading of the day. I didn't have to change it for anything. So what a sign from God that is. The Blessed Mother has been crowning our journey from the beginning to the end. And this gospel passage, first of all, a lot of our Protestant brothers and sisters who deny our belief that Mary was ever virgin try to use this as proof to us, saying, look, it mentions Jesus' mother and brothers. Well, there's lots of things that we can say in proof of the fact that this is not correct, that this does not mean Jesus has siblings. But rather, the word brother literally means male relative. So yes, your siblings would be your brother, conclusion of our journey. Let's look at all the things we've seen, all the many different churches we've visited, the saints we've encountered, people who have served the Lord in times of joy and in times of crisis, people for whom it was perhaps easy for them to follow the Lord, or so it seems to us, and people that we know from the get-go it was going to be great suffering for them. But through it all, we've found the triumph, remember that symbol of the palm branch that the martyrs had won with their triumph for a journey. It would hardly be worthwhile or have the same meaning if everything were easy in life. Just like our trip this week, we've had things that have gone just as we planned, and other times where buses didn't show up when we expected them to, and other things didn't happen the way we planned. But as I said before we came, that was the idea of the pilgrimage, that we're going on this journey, and part of the journey is, or the pilgrimage is, the trip itself, the experiences we have. Through it all, we've grown even closer. Those of you who know each other have grown into a further knowledge. And those who did not even know each other before this trip have become good friends. And that is something that is what the Lord intends to happen in our lives, that through each other, we come to know the Lord. When you hear people saying, I don't need to go to church on Sunday in order to know Jesus, you know, I can pray in my own room. Well, I would very much disagree with them. Yes, we can pray in our room. But most importantly, we cannot receive the Eucharist in our room. We cannot be united with Christ in his suffering, death, and resurrection by receiving his body and blood while we're in our room. And do we not find the support of each other in following God? Some of you, I know, I've been asking a few of you during the week how you first became friends, and a few of you have told me it was your teen club, that it was by joining our club that you got to know each other or got to know each other better and have become good friends. And that is, of course, to mean that you are brothers and sisters in Christ. And what does Jesus say in this gospel? Whoever obeys the will of my Father is my brother, my mother, my sister. And that's what you have done. You have allowed Christ to draw you together as one body, as one family in him. And that's what the word church means. The word ekklesia, which we take from the Greek ekklesia, literally means those drawn out. So the Lord draws us out of the world and binds us together to know him and go out and now bear witness to him to the world. We conclude our pilgrimage today. Tomorrow we go home, and let's pray that the Blessed Mother, who has been with us every step of the way and guided many of the saints that we saw this week, will be our special guide to help us remember that we have been drawn out of the world for one week. We left our homes and everything familiar to be drawn here, encounter the Lord together, to become one family in him. And now as we return, let us support each other with that family spirit we have and bear witness to Christ, so that anyone who sees us will indeed meet Christ through us, because we are his mother, his sister, his brother. May Jesus Christ be praised. Amen. Now and